I'm sorry I'm a bit late this morning. Welcome to church. We are in the ninth Sunday in the season of Pentecost. And the theme is that Jesus is the shepherd king like King David. He has compassion on the sheep. And he cares for the sick and the hungry and the lost. So that's the theme of the gospel today. Let us stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We'll sing our opening hymn, the traditional version of Psalm 23, "The Lord's My Shepherd." This is King David's shepherd psalm.
Oh,
Here I am to sing, and you're my God. Well, welcome if you're coming during the worship.
The theme of the service this morning in Pentecost 9 is that Jesus is the Shepherd King who fulfills God's promise to David and through the prophet Jeremiah that one day he would come himself as King to shepherd his people, Israel, to feed them and to tend to their needs. And so we see that in today's gospel reading. In this theme prayer, it's actually, the language is very tricky. It's very old English language. And basically it's saying, God, you know our needs. Please help us. Please meet our needs. And even we don't know what to ask. We're unworthy to ask. And you might think, well, how does this relate to the theme? Well, it's kind of like we're sheep. Sheep don't know what they need. They don't know where to lie down. They don't know where to find the grass. They don't know when they're safe, or when they're not safe, they don't know who they are without the shepherd. So this prayer is basically saying, Lord, you know what we need before we ask. Please help us provide what we need. So that's how it fits with the theme, actually. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's pray this very tongue-twister of a prayer together. We say together,
Almighty God, the fountain of all wisdom, you know our necessities before we ask, and our ignorance in asking. Have compassion on our weakness, and mercifully give us those things which for our unworthiness we dare not, and for our blindness we cannot ask. Through the worthiness of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You could conclude that the person who wrote these prayers was a very gifted writer and wordsmith, or you might conclude that they had too many whiskeys when they were writing them. Anyway, you know what necessities are? Who's seen the Jungle Book? You haven't seen the Jungle Book cartoon? No? You know Baloo sings, give me those bare necessities, those simple bare necessities. You know that? Necessities is the things you need. So that's what we're praying for in that prayer, that God will give us the bare necessities, the things we need for life. Please be seated for our first reading this morning, in which Jeremiah reaffirms the covenant promise to David of that he would come to be the shepherd king. Thank you, please. Covenant is the covenant with Abraham, a covenant with Moses, and there's a covenant with David. A covenant is a promise. God made a promise. And in today's gospel reading, we're going to hear how Jesus fulfilled that promise. Now, while we're hearing about David, we're going to say one of his songs, the 23rd Psalm, the most famous of David's songs. And I suggest, because it's so short and so famous, so meaningful, that we all say it together in unison. It's on page 2 in the bulletin. Let's read it together. If you can read, boys and girls, who can read? Any boys and girls can read? Can you read?
Yeah.
Let's read it all together aloud. We say together,
The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He revives my soul. He guides me along right pathways for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup is running over. Surely your goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The epistle reading, you know, is not part of this theme of the Shepherd King, but it's a beautiful reading from Ephesians, which echoes the theme of last week, that we are God's saints, God's people, God's house. And Amelia is going to read to us the epistle reading. Thank you.
Ephesians 2, verse 11 to 22. Remember that at one time, you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcision, by those who are called the circumcision, a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. Remember that you at the time, without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh he has made both groups into one, and has broken down the dividing wall, that is hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances, that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death the hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who are far off and peace to those who are near. For through him both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, with the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you are also built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
All right, boys and girls, and moms and dads, we're going to do a song which I did 3 years ago. When we did it 3 years ago, we had a lot of people. I think it was a Friendship Sunday. So I'm going to need your help. And I'm going to, because I'm not a dancer, I'm going to ask Auntie Sal to help me, because she will do this better than me. But maybe before I start the music, I can't come out, Sal, come help me. So this is a song. It's set to the song Ba 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 Ram, okay? But it's Ba Ba, we're lambs. So it's talking about how we are lambs in God's flock. Jesus is the shepherd, and we are the sheep in his flock. And so in this song, you need Ba Ba Ram, that comes from the 60s, so we need some 60s moves. And Sal and I haven't practiced this, okay? You know, I tend to torture people unexpectedly, so thank you. We have a big clap for Sal. So the first thing that we need to do, and again, please forgive me, I'm not a dancer and I'm ancient of days, but we need to do the sprinkler. So we need to move this arm around while you wobble the one on the left. Can you do that? So hold up your right hand and you put your left hand behind your head. I can't even do it. And you do like this, okay? Can you do that? Now, if you can't do both at once, because I'm a guy, I can't do two things at once. So I'm just going to do this, okay? I'm going to do this. Now, at the same time, before that, we need to do this thing, and again, I can't do this, where you kind of cock your hip on one side, and then you kind of go... Yeah, that's it. Like that. Can you do that? So can you guys do that? Stand up. Because we shouldn't be the only ones looking silly out here. We should also be looking silly. Do you know what I mean? You know what I mean. You're a dancer, right? It's a professional dancer. So, okay. So we start out with the hands on the hips. And we're doing the, you know. How do you do that? Alright. Do your best. Like that, and then it comes in like this, okay? And then we're going to do the mashed potato. I think it's the mashed potato. You do like this, punch, punch, and behind, punch, punch. Punch, 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 punch. And you can keep wiggling to the music, okay? And then there are other moves in this. So there's a move like this, okay? And then there's a move we're going to do like this. And then we're going to do, I think this is the ponytail, is it? And then anything else, any other suggestions you want to add, okay? Alright, I don't know how this is going to go, alright? So let's, anyway, the music is fun, and boys and girls, let's sing this one together. This is our gradual thing. Ha ha, we're masked. I've got to start it in one minute. Stay with me.
Thank you.
Thank you. Give a big clap for Sal. Our normal PA is not working. We don't know why, but the laptop won't go through the speakers in front of the house. But somehow, coincidentally, it went through the school system. We don't know why it's going through the school system, but that's why we have the audio and we can't control it. So we're going to do one more little song about being lambs, and it's called, by my friend Jerry, it's called Ba Ba Ba, God is the Shepherd. It's in this key, Ba Ba Ba, God is the Shepherd. Can you hear that? Pick up your guitar, see if you can follow me. She can do it, she knows it was him. Ba Ba Ba, God is the Shepherd. Ba ba, that's it. Ba ba, ba ba ba. Well, that's your mind, right? Ba ba ba, God is the shepherd. Okay. Ba ba ba, God is the shepherd. See if you can figure out what it means. Ba ba, that's it. That's it. But what key is that? What key is that? E, B flat. Really? Okay. Ba ba ba, that's it. Wow. Okay. So it goes like this, ba ba ba, God is the shepherd, ba ba ba, we are the sheep, ba ba ba, he owns the mountains, ba ba ba, follow his lead. All together, ba ba ba, God is the shepherd, ba ba ba, we are the sheep, ba ba ba, he owns the mountains, ba ba ba, follow his lead. Now I think we should do some actions. What can we do for shepherd? Ba ba ba, God is the shepherd. What's a shepherd? Oh, and Sal says hold a crook. The shepherd has a crook so it can guide the sheep. So we're going to hold the crook firmly so we can look after the sheep. Ba ba ba, God is the shepherd. Ba ba ba, sheep. Oh, this is the sheep. Okay, this is the sheep. Ba ba ba, we are the sheep. Ba ba ba, he knows the mountain. Ba ba ba, follow his lead. Let's do it all together. Ba ba ba, God is the shepherd. Ba ba ba, we are the sheep. Ba ba ba, he knows the mountains. Ba ba ba, follow his lead. Next verse. And if you're weak, he'll look after you. And if you're hurt, he'll bind up your wounds. But if you're strong and stout, you better watch out. You better not throw your weight around. So if you're weak, what can we do for that? If you're weak, what's an action for weak? If you're weak, he'll look after you, point to the person next to you. And if you're hurt, oh, I'm hurt, he'll bind up your wound. But if you're strong and stout, that means fat, you better watch out. You better not throw your weight about. Okay, let's try that. And if you're weak, he'll look after you. And if you're hurt, he'll bind up your wounds. But if you're strong and stout, you better watch out. You better not throw your weight about. Like the chorus. Chorus. Ba ba ba.
God will never pass.
Ba ba ba, God
is looking for you. And if you're hurt, you'll find us one for food. But if you're strong and stout, you better watch out. You better not throw your weight about. Ba ba ba, your heart is the shepherd. Ba ba ba, we are the sheep. Ba ba ba, he leads us the mountains. Ba ba ba, follow us too. And if you're lost, he's looking for you. And if you're hungry, you'll find me some food. But if you linger and cross and trample it flat, God won't have a bad, a bad. Ba ba ba, the Lord is the shepherd. Ba ba ba, we are the sheep. Ba ba ba, he knows the mountains. Ba ba ba, follow his lead.
Follow his lead. Follow his lead.
Another big clap for Andy Sermon. Pierre, guys, we need to get rid of this thing. It's started. Please remain standing for the gospel. Hallelujah.
Thank you. excited for the summer school.
You guys are going to be having a treat. You're going to meet a special guest. You're going to meet a special guest today at Sunday school. And he comes from a place called Gath, which is in modern-day Gaza. And he's very, very big. He's very, very tall. So I'm excited for you. You're going to meet a very special guest today. He's a little bit scary, but don't be scared, because God has won the battle. So, now from the announcements, I just want to continue to ask your prayers for a speaker for Church Camp. I've asked five really great speakers, and they're all busy that weekend. The good news is they're all interested to come later, so we might have some great speakers coming in a future year or two. But I haven't found someone yet for our church camp, so please pray for me. Secondly, please pray for our church member at 9 a.m. His name is Norma, and she's having surgery tomorrow for cancer, to remove cancer here in Macau. So please pray for Norma. And lastly, please save the date for church camp later in the year. Oh, and one more thing, if you would like to be confirmed, please get a confirmation application form. The bishop is coming at the end of September, and we will have confirmation, so we need to start collecting those forms. So thank you guys for being here. It's lovely to see so many people in the dark heart of the summer. Thank you for coming to worship with us. I think some of you are here for the first time, or the second time. It's lovely to have you. We welcome you. We're so pleased to see you, and hope you make yourself known to us later. Before you leave, we do have a newcomer form. Please fill in the newcomer form and pass it to me before you go, so we can have a record of your visit with us today. So thank you so much for being with us. Please take the bulletin with you. Please don't return it. We do it new every week. Some people return it. I don't know why. We were just a recycler. Throw it in the recycle. So please take it with you, so you know what's happening in the church, and also you can pray. There's a list of things you can use during the week to pray for the upcoming events and groups of the church. So thank you very much. We're going to stand, and the boys and girls, we're going to sing our dismissal song as they go to Sunday school. Thank you very much. Teenagers should stay with us in church. Thank you. Sit on a lot is the chair of work. Maybe you have a chair at work. When I was younger, I would go to the office every day, 6 days a week, and I would sit in my chair at 8:30 or 9, sometimes earlier in the morning, sometimes later, depending on what I was doing, and I would sit at my desk and work away. These days, my office is here, in the phone. So I can sit, instead of going into an office and sitting at a desk, I can sit on my sofa at home, and I can write sermons, and I can do emails and lists and plans and so on. So I do a lot there, because our office has changed. But still, we have offices and we have a workplace. Maybe your workplace is sitting on a machine driving a bus. Maybe it's you don't get to sit. Maybe you're standing all the time doing something.
So that's one kind of chair. Now, what does that chair say about theology? What does it say about God? Or what does it teach us about God? That's a tricky question, isn't it? There's other chairs in our life. For example, there's a birthing chair. In the old days, instead of being in a bed, people would sit in a chair to give birth to babies. And they had special chairs. I'll show you one later in the future, in which people would give birth. And that chair has a particular theology. It says something about God in our life. Because it speaks about creativity and hope. It also tells us that we are children of God, that He has created us, and He is our Heavenly Father, and He's our mother as well. The scripture says that the Spirit is in the feminine term, like a mother hen that looks after her chickens. So it's a feminine metaphor for God in the Bible as well. So there's that chair. And then there's the chairs in church. I wish they were more comfortable. I think they used to be more comfortable before, and they've still got these hard folding ones. I wish I could be in a church where I could control the chairs. Which movie cinema do you prefer? The one with the wooden benches? Or the one with padded seats? Or the one with the really big laid-back recliner seats? Which of the three do you prefer? One, two, and number three, right? So people prefer a more comfortable chair. I wish we had more comfortable chairs to make you more comfortable in church. I suppose maybe if they're uncomfortable, you might stay away from the sermon longer, but if we have to resort to that, we're going to do that. So what does that chair say, this chair, what does it say about your relationship with God? What does it say about your Christian life? What does this chair say? There are a lot of chairs in this life. When I was in Melbourne, I sat in a chemotherapy chair, sometimes in a wheelchair. If you're in a wheelchair, how is that going to affect your theology? And then there is, of course, the electric chair. If you're going to sit in the electric chair, that might influence your theology as well. That could be the valley of the shadow of death, wouldn't it, if you're in that chair. So I want you just to think, if you're totally confused by what I'm talking about, just think about what's your favorite chair? Or what's an unusual chair that you sat in? You could say, what's your favorite chair? Or you could say, what's an unusual chair that you sat in? Maybe others haven't sat in. And what does that chair mean to you? That's another way to put it. What's the meaning of that chair? And does it say anything about God, about our relationship with God? So it's a tricky question, deep question. Is there anybody confused? Okay. All right, never mind. See what you come up with, all right? So can we get into groups of, say, three or four? Not five. It's too many. Don't have time. I'm only going to give you 2 minutes. So three is good. Three or four is good. Just turn around, move your chair, get in a small group, and you can share an unusual chair you sat in, what it means to you, or you can share a chair that speaks to you something about God. This is a chair here. This is a throne. This chair is a throne. It's for the bishop, or it represents Christ. It's Christ's throne. It becomes. It represents the bishop's throne. He's the head pastor of the church. This is like way too many people. Can you split it in two groups of three, guys? Two groups of three. It's too many. Six is too many. Too many. Don't have that long. No more than four. Share about a chair you sat in. What's your favorite chair and why? What does it mean to you? Here's another way you can express the question. What is the most unusual chair you've sat in, and what is the most meaningful chair you've sat in? Maybe that's the way you can address the question.
The most unusual or the most meaningful?
Like
You've got 30 seconds. You're not going to hold the room and put their head up. So if you finish, feel free to turn back to them. Did anybody hear about any interesting chairs in their group? Anybody got any very novel or unusual chairs that they sat in? Okay. Yes, Matt. Oh, okay. B likes to sit on the luggage. That's very meaningful. Also, because it shows that you're going on holiday, God's got a rest and refreshment, so it says something to us about God that He wants us to be refreshed as we learn in the reading today. Anyone else have any unusual chairs that they've sat in? Matt has another one. Yeah. I like to sit in this like in the chairs, like the chemo chairs, or the climbing ones. Yeah, kind of.
Sometimes on the actual bed.
Sometimes on the bed. Okay, so your chair, you like the bed, it's a chair. I can relate to that. Yeah, John?
I sat on a boulder once.
A boulder? Yeah, that's a great chair. And you know, when we're out in nature, we sit on a boulder, it speaks to us of the wonder of God. You know, if you have a solid rock under your backside, it's a symbolic that God is a solid rock beneath our backside. God is a solid strength that we can rely on. If you have a look at the picture, there are different chairs in the picture. And in the top left, three people sitting in the dirt with a very sad looking chap. Does anybody know who they are? Who are those three men and the other man? Job, thank you. Thank you, Doctor. Exactly, that's Job and his comforters. Now, in the Bible, the story of Job is a sad story. Job had 10 children and he was very wealthy. And a big windstorm, a very, very twister came along. And all his family were killed, all 10 of his children. And his house was destroyed and he lost his crops and his business was destroyed. And then he got infection and he had boils and infection over his body. So he was really, really miserable. God was testing his loyalty because Satan asked to test Job. Satan said to God, if I test your servant Job, he will curse you. He will give up his faith. And God said, no, he will not. And so Satan gave him a different seat to sit in. He'd been sitting in a very comfortable father and grandfather seat. He was sitting in the general manager's seat of his business and his family. And then he found himself sitting in the dirt. That was a seat he'd not been used to sitting in. And his three friends came to see him. They liaised together. They organized to give him pastoral support. And we always give them a bad rap. The phrase Job's comforters is not a compliment. It's an insult. If you say, oh, somebody is Job's comforters, it means you're not very comforting. Because they came to him and they said, you must have done something wrong. You must have sinned to offend God. In fact, he hadn't. He was a righteous man. So they said, you should just curse God and die. And Job said, no, I haven't done anything wrong. I haven't sinned against God. So we call that kind of bad advice the advice of Job's comforters. But I realized this week, we studied this in the young adults group, that they got a bad rap. Because the first thing that they heard about Job being in trouble, they got together, and they organized themselves, and they came to visit him. Now, what do you say to a person who's lost all 10 of his children, his business, and his health, and his home in one blow? He could always get married again and have more children. I'm sure you can. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. You'll feel better eventually. Time heals all wounds. These are the kind of dumb things we say to people in grief. Don't say any of those things. What did Job's friends say to him that was helpful?
Nothing.
They said nothing. They said nothing for 7 days. Day and night, they sat in the dirt with him in the midst of his suffering for 7 days and nights and said nothing. I reckon these guys are heroes. I reckon they would get a medal. You know, instead they've gone down in history as a sort of idiot pastoral counseling team. But the first thing they did, their first instinct was to say nothing. The problem was when they opened their mouth, then they got into trouble. The This is often the case with us, right? Now, that seat says something about your theology. When you're sitting on the general manager's chair and you're running a big business, you've got lots of camels and vineyards and cows and everything's going well, you've got 10 children and a lovely wife and a beautiful home, how is that going to influence your theology? You say, well, God has blessed me. God is good all the time. Put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. God is good. I'm blessed. You're not blessed. Oh, too bad. But God is good, right? God's blessed me. So then if you're sitting in the dirt and you've lost everything, how does that influence your theology? Well, it might or it might not. You might say, God's not so good, not all the time. I'm not sure I like it anymore. At this time, you say, well, where are you, God? Why do you let this happen to me? Is that what Job did? No. He maintained his integrity and his faith in God, even though his seat had changed. Now, very often for us, we shape our theology based on where we're sitting. If we're sitting in the bishop's throne, we might be, God is good, I'm the bishop, everybody has to do what I say, get the pay, the highest salary, everything is wonderful, I drive a big car, and nobody will criticize me, you know, God is good all the time, you know, might be saying that. Or he might be giving away, we don't know, privately he might be giving away all his money to the poor and helping the needy, we wouldn't know, necessarily. But you might well be influenced by your theology. You might live in a wealthy, comfortable society where you're middle class and everything is pretty good, and then it's easy to say, I love you, Lord, everything is wonderful, thank you so much for blessing me. And in the West, we equate the chair we sit in with God's blessing. If we have a comfortable chair, and literally we are living in a wealthy circumstance, we say, oh, God has blessed you, brother. Are money and salary and homes, are these things God's blessing? I don't think so. I don't think so. I think that's a false equivalency. I think it's false to say, I'm wealthy, therefore God has blessed me. Now, we can say all things come from the Lord, and so that is, in general, God's blessing. But I don't think it's right to say, to use this idea that, oh, you went on a holiday to Alaska and you went on a cruise. Oh, that's really God's blessing. I would discourage you from using that language. When the man was lowered down through the ceiling who had been crippled, it was a crippled man, and his friends brought him to Jesus, and they dug a hole in the roof, and they lowered him down so that Jesus could heal him. Jesus didn't say, be healed. What did he say? Your sins are forgiven. Because Jesus knew that that was the need of the man's heart. The man had been crippled, we don't know how long. Now, if you're crippled and you need help, do you want someone coming and say, oh, your sins are forgiven? But the leaders of the Pharisees, the religious leaders, got angry because they said, only God can forgive sins. Jesus said, oh, okay, watch this. Which is easier, to say, brother, your sins are forgiven, or to say, crippled man, take up your mat and walk home. But because you, so you would know that I have authority to forgive sins, turned to the man and said, son, take up your mat and walk. And the man took up his mat and he was healed. So the point of the story is to tell us that Jesus is the Messiah and he can forgive sin. But Jesus knew that the blessing he needed was not physical healing. The blessing that, I mean, he needed that too, but the main blessing he needed was forgiveness of sin. Now, we don't know what his sins were. We don't, I mean, what are the sins of a crippled man? What can you do when you're crippled? Well, bitterness, hatred, resentment, vengeful heart, I don't know. Maybe his heart was full of anger and pain and bitterness. Maybe he hated God. Maybe his theology had been shaped by his chair, his crippled bed. His bed. Maybe he had come to resent God and hate God. We don't know. But Jesus gave him the gift of forgiveness of sin. I once met a young man, and he was
single,
and he'd grown up in a Baptist church, very religious family in New Zealand. You know, New Zealanders send more missionaries per capita than any other nation on earth. They're very missionary-minded people, and very, very Christian, religious people, historically. And he came from a very strict, very committed Baptist family, and he was the only non-Christian. And I was sitting next to him at a wedding banquet, and I said, "Dude, how come you're the only non-Christian?" He said, "Oh, when I was 18 years old, I fell in love with this girl, and I prayed that she would fall in love with me and marry me, and she turned me down and went with another guy, and I was brokenhearted, and I've never forgiven God for that." This was like 20 years earlier. He said, "I hate God, I can never forgive God for doing that to me." So he was sitting in the bachelor's chair, and he was holding that against God in bitterness. You see, his seat had shaped his theology. There's a very famous British artist who does a lot of the paintings for the Nicky Gumbel, the Alpha Course. Is it Charlie McKeithy? And Charlie McKeithy was an atheist. And one of his main arguments that there was no God was all the suffering people in Africa. And when people would say, "Well, what's your, why don't you believe in God?" He would say, "Well, look at all the suffering people in Africa. You know, their lives are terrible because they're in poverty. So I can't," and this is a wealthy Nobel, Royal Laureate, you know, artist and queen, all this kind of thing, prize winning, his painting sell for hundreds of, you know, thousands and thousands of pounds. Wealthy, successful artist, I mean, how many of those are there? Living in the UK, he's like, "I don't believe in God because of all the poor people in Africa." So one day, through the circumstances of life, guess where he went? Africa. Guess what he found? He met the people in Africa. And time after time after time, he met these people living in poverty, and they love God, and they're full of joy. And their lives were full of the praise of God and faith in God and joy in the things of God. And they taught him about their love for Jesus, their love for God. And Charlie McKeithy said, "All my argument was pulled out from under my feet. Because if these people who are poor love God so genuinely and are so loving and so generous with the little they have and were living really joyful lives in their poor circumstances in the village, if they can believe in God, then who am I not to? What right do I, with my Mercedes and my comfortable life and my millions of pounds, what right do I have to not believe in God?" So that's one of the things that brought him to faith in Christ together with the Alpha Course. So you see, where we sit influences our theology. But, next slide please, Jim. How you sit indicates your, it influences your philosophy. So you can be sitting in the dirt with Job, and you might be inclined to say, "Well, I don't believe in God because I've lost my family and I'm sick and life is terrible." Or you can change your philosophy. See, philosophy is your mind. Your belief is your heart, your faith. So you can change your attitude. It's another word is attitude to life. Like Job. Job's friends was saying, "Your suffering proves that you've sinned, you've offended God." They didn't say, "Don't believe in God." They just said, "You've offended God, must be. Therefore, curse God and die." You know, effectively become an atheist. Curse God and die. And Job says, I will not curse my Creator. In the end of the book, he kind of breaks, doesn't he? He kind of cries out to God, "Why have you let this happen to me? Why have I had to suffer this? I've never offended you. I've always done everything right." You know, and God says to Job, "Where were you when I created the world? Where were you when I measured the waters of the ocean? Where were you when I hung the stars in the sky? Where were you when I planned the tapestry from the beginning?" And Job realizes that there's nothing he can say. God knows the end from the beginning. And of course, in the story, he repents. He humbles himself, and God then restores everything he's lost many times over. And he is blessed. He's blessed. And yet God restores all the things that he's lost. See, our theology is influenced by where we sit. There are some other chairs here. On the left, there's the armchair. I spend far too much time in the armchair. In yesterday's gospel reading, There are three times in the reading. Now, as I said to you, this reading is kind of two bookends. And in the middle, the sandwich in the middle of these two bookends of today's gospel reading is the feeding of the 5,000 and Jesus walking on water. And so, very quickly, if you can imagine the Sea of Galilee is like an Easter egg, okay? And Capernaum, or Gennesaret as it's called here, is on the west, on the left. Your left is over here, isn't it? It's on the left. And so they've been ministering to people, and they've come back from their mission trip. And they've been caring for the sick, and they've been seeing people healed, and they've been preaching about Jesus and the kingdom. And they're tired. And they come back, and the people are still crowding around. And people still want to see Jesus. They're saying, Jesus, heal us. You know, I've told you before, Jesus was very quickly a rock star. You live in a society where there's no hospitals, no injections, no painkillers, no Panadol, and you get somebody who can heal diseases, you're going to be flooded with people. But he had a message to get out. So dealing with all the sick people constantly, he wasn't able to get out his message. He wasn't able to train his disciples for when he'd be gone and so on. So all the crowds are coming in, and now the disciples have been out doing the ministry too. They've been healing the sick. They've been preaching the good news. So they get caught up with it, and everybody's tired. And Jesus says what? What does Jesus say? In your gospel, in your bulletin. Many were coming and going. They had no leisure. They couldn't even eat. They didn't have time to sit at the table, the dining seat, at the dining table. They were in the work seat all the time. Work, work, work. Help, help, help. Serve, serve, serve. And what does Jesus say? Come away to a deserted place, all by yourselves. And rest a while. And so they got in the boat and they went to sail to a deserted place. Now, come back to my, remember the Easter egg, the Sea of Galilee? Gennesaret and Capernaum is over here. So what they did is sail about 4 miles to the north, which was a very deserted area. This is where the feeding of the 5,000 took place. We know from tradition and people remember, you know, they're not going to forget something like that. So a lot of these places were marked with churches. This one wasn't, but we know where it happened, we're pretty sure. So there were villages up there, but not many. Bethsaida and Chorazin were up there, which were later destroyed. But so anyway, they sail up, it's 4 miles, but if the wind is against you and you're tacking into the wind, it's a bit slow. And people can go 10 kilometers around the lake, and so that's what they did. So the crowds heard where they'd gone. Somebody saw them kick off in the boat, and they said, hey, they're going up to the north, to the fields. Let's go around and meet them. So they got all the sick people, and they ran around the lake. Now, that's actually possible. If the wind is slow, you can get there first. So when they arrive, for the second time, they're overwhelmed by a crowd of people. Now, here's the thing. Jesus is saying to his disciples, when you're overwhelmed from sitting in the work seat, you need to move and sit in the isolated seat. You need to sit in the rest seat. You need to go to a deserted place all by yourself. This is called a retreat. You need to sit in the retreat chair or lie in the retreat bed. Now that sofa there, that's a kind of retreat bed. You could sit in there. Now the problem for me is I'm confused. I'm a confused puppy because I can sit in that chair and watch Netflix, or I can sit in that chair and sleep. I sleep better sitting up than lying down because sleep apnea. Or I can sit in that chair and work all day with my little phone. And you know, we're confused these days because we don't know what chair is for what. And we sit in the home resting armchair seat, and we are working, working, working. When we need to be resting and being with family, we need to figure out what seat we're in and get into the right seat and have a rest. Jesus says, come and have a rest. So they're having a rest, and the whole crowd turns up. And they come in such a rush that they forget their lunch and their dinner. So there's 5,000 people with no food. And so Jesus has to do the 5,000, feeding the 5,000, turning the loaves and the fishes into feed all the people. And then they're exhausted from that, and Jesus is like, oh, come on, let's run away. So the disciples get in the boat. I'm not sure where Jesus went, but he's kind of somehow disappeared. Maybe he went off to be alone. And then there's a storm at night, and then they see him walking on the water. He's coming towards them on the water. And then, you know, they come back to Gennesaret, and guess what happens a third time? All the people are there. They're all waiting for them. So this is in your reading today. So they come back, they cross over, and when they got out of the boat, the people recognized him. And they rushed around the whole region and began to bring the sick on the mats and wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, in the villages or the farms, and they put the sick in the marketplaces and they begged him that he might touch it in the fringe of his coat and all he touched would heal. So it's like he couldn't escape. They were chasing him everywhere. Jesus was always trying to go away to a quiet place. Guys, we need times when we go away to a quiet place. We need time. We need to figure out what the chairs are. Because the chairs influence your theology. There's some other chairs there just for fun. The one next to the sofa with the white background, to believe it or not, that's actually a church chair. That's a marketed church chair. You can buy that online. Wouldn't it be great to have those for church instead of these ones? Everyone would fall asleep. I wonder what it would say about our theology if we had all comfy chairs in church. We're here to rest and to learn. When you're in church, you're here to rest and learn. Some people want to stay in church. Some people have comfy chairs like that in their church. And they want to stay in church all the time. They never want to leave. They never want to go home. They never want to go out in the world because they have comfy chairs in church like that. But actually, life is about balance. And the story from Jesus today is telling us we need balance, or politically incorrect to say balance. You know, in the Karate Kid, he says balance. We need balance. Daniel's son, we need balance. Okay. Politically incorrect. We need more balance, right, in our life. We need balance. We need time to rest and time to work, time to love, time for family, time to eat. And we have all these different chairs. And I'm a bit of an idiot because what I do is I eat in the sofa, I sleep in the sofa, I relax in the sofa, and I work in the sofa. There's probably one major activity that I don't do in the sofa, and that's on the other seat in the bathroom. So, but you know, there's some people who do that as well, they have special sofas. So, Lord have mercy. So, you have here a table, it's better to have separate seats. Now, my wife is very good at this. She gets up 4:30 or 5 in the morning. She goes to bed at 8:30 or 9. What she does is she sits on a seat in the window box. It's a window box. She has a cushion there. She sits cross-legged with her Bible. She spends an hour and a half. She reads the Bible. She does a prayer journal. And she prays before anything else. And when we were and I was having a chemotherapy, we all in one room, no bedrooms, just one room, kitchen, bed, sofa, TV, study, everything in one room. Fortunately, there was a curtain. So she needs to get away from me. She needs two things. She needs coffee, and she needs to get away from everybody. And so what she would do is pull the curtain, and leave me in the room on my sick bed, and then she would go and sit by the window. Fortunately, there was a desk, thank God, that was God's provision. And she could look out the window at the birds and read the Bible and pray. She would sit on her prayer seat. Then, for the rest of the day, here, now, she sits at her desk. And she has a Mac computer because she's an IT person. And she designs a Sunday school. Before you go today, go and have a look at Goliath out there. It's amazing. It's 9 feet high, life-size illustration of Goliath for Sunday school. It's like, wow. And so she designs all the crafts and the lessons and all the things. And she spent hours and hours and hours sitting there from 9 in the morning till 5 every day. All this time, I'm sitting on the sofa. Unless I'm going out and having groups and meeting people and doing things. And I'm there on my phone working away. Sometimes I sit in the desk if I need the laptop and print things. So, and then she sits at her desk and sometimes she sits on the floor because Thai people work on the floor. And then at 5 o'clock or 5:30 every day she stops work. And we order a Genji Lai Cha. And we watch a funny program on TV, or she only lets me watch what's it called, Hallmark Romance Christmas comedies. I've seen every Hallmark Christmas Romance Christmas comedy. Do you know what? It's very good for your soul. Because at the Christmas hour, when I couldn't sleep, I would watch a Hallmark Romance Christmas comedy and fall asleep. It was so boring for me, you know, I like action movies, you know. But it's good for my soul because they sing Christmas Carol and I feel peaceful and it is good for me. So she sits on the relaxation sofa. And then about 8:30 or 9, she falls asleep. And then my job, what I have to do is pick her up and shuffle. I used to carry her when we were younger, but now I can't anymore. So I hold her, shuffle to the bed, put her in the bed. She's already asleep, right, before she hits the bed. And then she sleeps in the bed. So I'm basically a mixed up chicken, okay? Sorry, you've got a pastor who's a mixed up chicken. But fortunately, his wife is a very wise woman because she knows which chair is for which. And each chair has a theological significance in your life. And what Jesus is saying in the story today is we need balance. We need time to minister to the needs of others, and we need time to rest and to read the Bible and to pray. We need time to be with God. And then we need time to work. Now, when she's working, she's serving others. So that's the seat of service as well. The problem with us today is the me, exhibit A. We mix up all the seats. There's some other fun seats. I'm not going to go into them all, but there's the dining seat. The three in the middle are all stressful. Sometimes we're on the exam seat or the chemotherapy seat or the wheelchair seat. That really influences your theology. It really makes you think. And you know what? I got closer to God on the chemo seat, which was a kind of exam, and the wheelchair seat. I got closer to God and closer to my wife during those 2 months than I have ever been in my life. Isn't that interesting? We think, oh, what a terrible seat, the chemo seat, oh, how horrible. The wheelchair seat, how terrible. That's when you fall in love again with your wife. That's when you pray together. When you're in trouble, that's when you have to cry out to God. See, it affects your theology. It's like, where are you, Lord? I'm sorry I don't pray very well. I'm sorry I don't read the Bible like I should. I'm sorry I'm not a Christian. I should. I come here. I want to fix it, Lord. Please help me. Please help me. Crying out. Okay. Changes your theology. But where you sit can influence your theology. But how you sit, your attitude, that affects your attitude. You can be like Job, or you can be like Job's comforters. You can have a plot. Even on the right, does anybody, the one at the top is Queen Elizabeth's throne. Does anybody know what the one in the middle is? It looks like a torture device, doesn't it? It's a birthing chair. The one in the middle is a birth chair. You see there's a big gap in the middle for the baby to come out. And the bit sticking forward are the stirrups. So the lady can put her feet in the stirrups and the baby's born. So that's a birth giving chair. People in the past usually had babies sitting in chairs. That's the most of human history. People would give birth with stools or chairs. So birthing chair. So what's the one at the bottom? That's the electric chair. So you've got the chair coming in and the chair going out. And the interesting thing is, you may say, well, I'm never going to be on the electric chair because I'm not going to commit any crime, so I won't be executed. But here's the thing, it's a symbol. It's like the cross. What does it symbolize? Death, obviously, right? It symbolizes death, obviously. So it represents the fact that we're all going to die. We're all going to sit on the electric chair. And when you first get cancer and you don't know what kind of cancer it is, you're like, oh, I'm going to die. You know, I'm on the electric chair. Now, that can affect your theology. There's an old saying, there are no atheists in foxholes. Foxhole is a hole in a war, you know, the soldier hides in because an enemy is shooting at them. And it's like, everybody in every foxhole ever is like, oh God, save me! You know? It's like, everybody in every foxhole ever in history is like suddenly a believer in God because suddenly you're in a desperate situation and you need help. And it is not completely true, but it is often true. That people turn to God when in times of trouble and times of need. And often when we're sitting on the electric chair, we get a reprieve at the last minute, and we'll get a pardon from the governor, and maybe your cancer is not so deadly, and maybe the treatment is able to help you, or maybe somehow your life gets spared from the axe that's hanging over you, and you get a second chance. But how you sit on the chair shapes your life. So you can sit on the electric chair and you can be like, I hate you, I hate the world, you know, the heck with everybody else. You can die in defiant, like, you know, goodbye, cruel world. Or you can be on the electric chair and you can say, oh God, I'm sorry, I've wasted my life. I've been a criminal, I've been mean, I've been a poor husband and father. Have mercy, Lord, help me to do better. Forgive my sin. Have mercy. And that's why there's always a priest. Traditionally in Christian society, there'd be a priest who would attend and meet with the person to hear their confession before they face execution. Because often when people sit on that chair, they suddenly find that their theology changes and their attitude can be positive or negative. So in today's story, Jesus is the shepherd and he pours himself out to care for the sheep. Without the shepherd, the sheep are lost in the people in Israel. Jesus says that Jesus had compassion on them. Now I want to ask you a question. I'm nearly finished. I want to ask you a question. If you are with your friends and you go away from work to get away from all the clients and the irritating customers, and you go for a retreat together, and you just arrive at the beach and you're going up into the hills and you're going to camp out and cook sausages and drink some wine and sing Kumbaya and have a bit of a sleep and get away from a madding crowd, and you get up there and lo and behold, some idiot has leaked the fact that you're all on a retreat and has told all the customers and clients where you are, and they all come and turn up at your retreat place. How are you feeling? You'd be feeling very annoyed, you know, like, who leaked this and why are you all here? Give me a break, you know. This is the second time you're going to come after me, and that's exactly what Jesus does, right? Because, you know, Jesus is quite capable of telling people off. He's very capable of telling off the Pharisees and the hypocrites. So he tells them off, he gives them peace of mind, is that right? Did anybody read the gospel? Is that right? What does it say? It says, wrong page. It says, he saw a great crowd and he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. And after he taught them many things, he fed them. He fed them. And I just love this about Jesus. I'm a class A, gold-plated idiot. I really am. And I know you're so kind, you so honor me as your pastor, and you know, sometimes people put you on a pedestal when you're a pastor, and I always try and climb down, because I know I don't deserve to be here. And I'm just a class A idiot Christian, basically. And Jesus has every right at every turn to be annoyed with me. And yet he doesn't. He says he has compassion on all the idiot sheep. And he saw that they were lost. And he began to teach them. And then he fed them. And then he ran away. And then he found them again the next day at Gennesaret and continued to help them and serve them. And so I just want to say to you today, reflect where you're sitting. Where are you sitting? You know, sometimes people just sit in church all the time. They may leave church, but they're always like, I'm a Christian, but they never serve. They never get into the seat of service. They just want to sit at the feet of Jesus and do nothing. Is that you? Are you always sitting at the feet of Jesus and doing nothing to serve your brothers and sisters? And sometimes people just work all the time. And they never take a retreat and they never pray and they never spend time in the presence of God and have a quiet time. Get away from it all. You need a rest. On Monday, all I want to do on Monday is sleep. Oh, I get often 10 to 15 texts on Monday. My wife is like, I mean, do you understand me? I make jokes, nobody laughs. I'm not very good at jokes. You know, all I want to do on my day off is sleep. And I feel guilty. And I'm like, oh, God, I have so many things to do. She said, sleep. And 2 hours later, I'm like, I've got so many things to do. I need to get up. I need to do this. I need to do that. She said, sleep. It's okay to sleep. 3 hours later, I'll be like, oh, I've still haven't done all those things. I always get a head start on Tuesday. I need to get a head start because there's too much to do. She'll be like, sleep and eat. A command I'm very happy to follow. So, you know, we need that. We need someone in our life. And we need to discern what chair are you sitting in. Are you in the right chair? You need to change chairs. Because your chair determines your theology and influences your theology. And it expresses your theology. And it also depends on what your attitude is. How you sit in the chair, the attitude you have, indicates your heart and your philosophy of life. So Jesus has compassion on the sheep. And he doesn't judge them because they're tired, and he cares for them, he feeds them, he looks after them. So I want to say to you today, reflect on where you're sitting. Are you in the right place? Do you need to move sometimes? You need to balance where you're sitting. Move here, move there. That's healthy and normal. But also just remember that Jesus always loves you. He's always the shepherd. He's always ready to teach, always ready to feel and to heal. He loves you. Without Jesus, to close, we are lost. We are like sheep who are lost. We can't find a way. Without the shepherd, we don't know where to sit. We don't know where to rest. We don't know where the green, Psalm 23, we don't know where the green pasture is. We don't know where the still water is. We think it's on Netflix. Everybody thinks it's on Netflix. There's no green pasture and still water on Netflix. There's nothing for your soul on Netflix. You need to find that in the scripture. You need to find it in the presence of Jesus with the shepherd. And also, the sheep don't know how to defend themselves. They don't know how to deal with temptation. So we get in trouble. If you fall into serious temptation, it can really ruin your life. I mean, adults know this. Adults don't want young people to fall into serious temptation because it can wreck your future. We adults are quite happy to dive into serious temptation ourselves and wreck our future on our own. But we need the shepherd because without him we get lost. Without him we don't know where to sit. Without him we don't know how to feed our soul. And without him, we don't have defense against the enemy of our soul. So as I close today, that's really my message for you is to ask you, well, where are you sitting? Do you need to change chairs? What does it mean? And what's your attitude to the place that you're sitting? Are we like Job, or are we like the defiant person on death row? Let's just take a moment to be still. My 45 minutes is up. I just invite you to close your eyes and to be still. And to say, Jesus, I'm here. The scripture says, be still and know that I am God. I am exalted above the heavens. Jesus comes to us in our weariness. I will never leave you or forsake you. He teaches us. He accepts us. He loves us. He shows us where to sit. You know why? I don't want to retire. I'm afraid that if I retire, I'll sit on the sofa and never be done. But would you you please stand? We're going to sit in the seat of faith. Let us profess our faith together as we declare, we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was incarnate in the Virgin Mary and became a man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Please be seated as we pray. Next slide, please. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for our Archbishop Andrew, not Paul, and for bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments. We pray for all the government and all authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from grief or trouble. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs and for those of others. We just have a moment of silent prayer. Please pray for Norma at our 9 a.m. service, who's having surgery for cancer tomorrow, for healing and successful surgery. And any other prayer that you wish to pray for. We do especially pray for Norma that you would lay your healing hand upon her, work through the skill of the surgeons and the nurses, and grant her a successful surgery to remove all the cancer, and grant her a full and perfect healing. In your name we pray. Amen. We confess our sin together in this corporate confession as we say, most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in public and private meeting.
Dear friends, hear these words of assurance. May Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you all your sin through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Would you please stand for the greeting of peace? Having made our peace with God, we share our peace with one another. We are the body of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another with the love and the shalom of the blessing of God. Thank you.
cold, but some people are freezing. Is anyone else freezing? You're freezing. Matt, can you tell them to turn it off? Matt, just say turn all off for a little while, and then put one on in 15 minutes.
Please be with you.
Let us sing our offertory hymn, Lord that I am, and all that I am. By the way, if we have anyone here that's skilled with soldering, we have a little piece of equipment that needs soldering and fixing. So if you're good at fixing little electronic things, can you see me afterwards? Thank you. Let's sing All That I Have and All That I Have.
Praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord.
God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest.
And now, Father, we pray that we who receive these your gifts of bread and wine, according to our Savior's word, may be partakers of his body and his blood. For on the night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, his almighty Father, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took a cup of wine, and again, giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." We declare together the gospel acclamation. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And we pray,
sanctify these gifts by your Holy Spirit to be for your people, the body and blood of your Son. We offer our prayer and praise, Father, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Blessing and honor and glory and power are yours forever and ever. Amen.
And as our Savior Christ taught his disciples, we are confident to pray,
"Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen."
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
We do not deceive the quantity of the table of the Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your faithful and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather at the cross of the table, but you are the same Lord whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in you and be in us.
The gifts of God for the people of God, his body broken and his blood shed. Let us take him in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. If the children come in, please grab a hold of the children. Sidesmen, please send the children to mom and dad. Thank you.
today. It's lovely to have quite a good crowd of friends here for the middle of summer. So many people away at the moment. So it's lovely to see you all. Do please stay for morning tea and coffee after the service. I also just want to say I'm so sorry to hear that people were freezing during the sermon. Please don't suffer in silence. If you're freezing, other people probably are. And we don't want people to come to church and become frozen vegetables. So you can always say something to the guy here in white, the server, or to one of the sidemen. You see, Chris over by the pillar, he or one of the servers can fix it. So please speak up if it's too hot or too cold. Having said that, it's probably wise to bring a light jacket to church during this season, because some feel the cold's undone. So, yeah. I feel like there's something else I need to announce. Is it somebody's birthday or something? Anyway, let us pray as we give thanks. We remember that God fulfilled his promise by sending his son, the descendant of King David, to be our shepherd king, and that Jesus is our good shepherd. We give thanks as we pray together. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. Bless you guys. Unto God's gracious mercy and protection, I commit you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance on you and give you peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and those whom you love, now and forevermore. Amen. Close as we sing, Father, I place into your hands.
Thank you.